Welcome to the Sunset Safari, and look who it is. It is the Queen of Juma, Karula, the dominant female leopard in the area. And it seems like our leopard luck has been broken, and we are able to find a leopard on this Sunset Safari. Now, we are back at that impala kill that we showed you on the Sunrise Safari. She's moved it slightly, fed a little bit. Now, the big question is, are the little ones here? And I cannot say yes or no yet. They could be off lying in the shade somewhere where we can't see them at the moment. So there is a big possibility that she went back to fetch the cubs. And the kill is in the heart of that thicket. So here we go. You can just see the male impala behind there. Now we're on Juma Private Game Reserve, right in the sort of western sectors and off a road called Impala Road. Now Dave and I are carefully checking and listening under every bush to see if we might see those little ones. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Dangerous Dave on camera. We have Jamie and VM out in the other vehicle, and Rebecca and Louise in final control. But what a way to start Sunday's Sunset Safari with the Queen of Juma, Karula, who is being irritated by the flies at the moment. There we go. As I said, the biting flies are giving her a bit of a hard time. But other than that, she's quite a content leopard at the moment. Nice stash of meat just behind her. Got a nice shady spot to rest up in. Now, we are hoping that she hoists this kill. When I say hoist, I mean take up a tree, because if she leaves it on the ground, with the amount of hyenas we have in this area, it's quite possible she might lose it. Now, you can see that little shiver through her fur, and that is a response to those biting flies. Dave, I don't know if you're going to get it, but just come out quickly. Oh, don't worry, it's gone. There was a little blue pansy, a very pretty butterfly that landed on the dashboard for a second. But it disappeared. So I'm watching that thicket behind very carefully, because a leopard cub is such a small little creature that it could be hiding in the shade there, in the dark shade around the base of that weeping wattle. But no such luck yet. So we're definitely going to have to sit here for the long haul. Let's see if these cubs arrive. But while Dangerous Dave and I do the absolutely terrible job of having to sit with the leopard for a few hours, let's go say hello to Jamie.
What an awesome way to start off our sunset safari. But with the Queen of Juma herself, this morning held so much promise, and I'm so glad that she's come back to join us. In the meantime, we've got some interesting things happening here with the harvester termites. It looks as though we've got quite a few soldiers out. Yet I can't entirely work out what they're doing. Some of them carrying and harvesting seeds. What surprises me about this scene is just how hot it is. What on earth is going on? Termites are nocturnal or cold weather. They're active. They're not out in the middle of the day in the bright sunlight. I wonder what it is that's got them furiously harvesting away at this blade of grass. Almost looks like, I don't know, at first I thought they might be fighting each other. It might be Thank you to the large pachyderms that are actually all around us. That's how we found them. We stopped to have a look at an entire herd of elephants. Sorry, distracted myself completely. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have Viam on camera with me, and we're biding our time before we can head across to where we left, who I think is Inkanyeni. We had a female leopard this morning, but we were struggling to get signals, so we never really got the perfect look at her face. But as far as I know, it was her. So we'll be heading to her, and it feels as though this Sunday we have broken our leopard drought in spectacular fashion. There's one of our ellies. Most of them have moved off by now. I got so distracted by the termites. Viam actually spotted them. He heard them rustling about. There's a male, a little bit separate from the herd. He's still too young to have left, but he's old enough now to be right on the outskirts of the rest of the group. Punching away on a bush willow. A very varied start to the afternoon for us, from one of the smallest creatures to the absolute biggest. I think this might be the same herd that Brent had this morning on the Sunrise Safari, and I saw some of the clips that our viewers kindly put up of that elephant sighting with Brent and the young bull that was throwing sticks at him. He pulled up a trunk full of plant material and then quite clearly chucked it at Brent. It was very entertaining to watch. I love it when they do that. Speaking of Brent, I'm going to let you go back. We're not going to keep you from Karula for much longer. Enjoy her.
So there we go. Queen Karula still has not moved an inch, apart from the occasional twitch to try combat those biting flies. Now, the most annoying fly if you're a leopard is a little species of fly called a stable fly that looks almost exactly the same as a house fly. The major difference with them is that they are quite vicious little blood suckers, so they do bite, and we often notice wounds on the predator's ears and even the prey species ears, and that is from that stable fly. Now there's some very upset little wax bulls behind us. I wonder what they have seen that we can't. So in the little tree here there's some very small birds that are, yeah, they're right in the center of this little thorn tree right next to us. To the left, literally, unfortunately, there we go. So I wonder if there's a little cub wandering around somewhere behind us that we can't see. Not that I can see at the moment. There we go, you can see that little blue bird making lots of noise and a little bit upset. We are checking carefully. I haven't seen any sign of the cubs, but birds are quite good at spotting them. They could just be alarming at Queen Karula herself, the audacity of the little birds, but we will be keeping an eye out. The cubs could definitely be here, and it's not uncommon that when you arrive, especially with Karula's cubs, they haven't spent as much time around vehicles as some of the other cubs in the area, so they're not quite as relaxed. So playing the patience game, that could be very important in terms of seeing those cubs, just sitting here waiting it out. So while we continue to wait here with Queen Karula, let's go back to Jamie, who's got an interesting elephant to show you.
Now, I know that I said that I wasn't going to take you away from Queen Karula for too long, but I just had to try and get you a view of this very interesting female elephant. And she's now hidden her face as though realizing that we're looking at her. The thing that makes her so special is she's missing an ear completely. I mean, there's hardly anything there. And I'm just wondering if maybe if I don't go backwards and we can't actually get you a clearer view. We did have a view of her earlier, but she moved off. What you gonna do, girl? Right, so clearly her one ear is absolutely fine and fully functioning, but her other ear is a total stump, and I don't think I've ever seen such a completely missing ear before. We've seen elephants without trunks, we've seen elephants without tusks and tails, but this is a first. There you go. That's so surreal. It almost makes her look like an Asian elephant or an Indian elephant when you look at her from that angle. I have no idea if that was a birth defect or if it was due to some kind of an injury, maybe something similar to what we chatted about with James and that tailless elephant. Unfortunately, she is moving off. But just one of those little oddities that the bush has to offer. If you have any thoughts and opinions as to how it is she might have lost that ear, or if you have any questions on the subject of elephants, leopards, or anything out here in the African bush, please send those through to #SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. We absolutely love to hear from you, and it's like kind of like having you right on the back of the vehicle with us. I don't know what happened to that elephant's ear. I'm a little bit bemused. But it was just something that I thought might be interesting to you. We're going to go across and check Sydney's dam, and while we do, back to the Queen of Juma herself.
So there we go. She's still lying in the shade of that weeping wattle, not too far from the carcass. The little wax bills have moved off, so it's possible they were alarm calling at Queen Karula. Now, for those of you who might be a little bit new, a little bit of history to Queen Karula, she's the dominant female leopard in this area. Oh, there we go. And there's a very distinctive marking on her forehead, and it almost spells out wow. Wait till there we go. You can see that right between her eyes. Let's watch her behavior very carefully here. So she's about 12 years old, and she has given the Safari Live crew much wonderful sightings over the years, and she's one of the most successful mothers around. Okay, I'm just going to reposition the car. Looks like she might feed again. Are we behind us there, Dad? Okay, so we're just going to get around to the other side. And she's going to feed off. It's a young male, not this year's baby, but last year's baby that she's caught. Now, that's quite a big piece of meat for her. And she might struggle to hoist it. So what she might do is remove the stomach. Get a little window in there. How's that, Dave? Back. There we go. And then you can see, like with most cats, even lions to a degree will pluck the fur from the carcass like she's doing at the moment. Oh, you can hear elephants screaming in the background, quite far off. as I was saying about Queen Karula, one of the more successful female leopards in terms of rearing cubs in this area. At the moment, she's got two cubs. It looks like to be a male and a female. And she's trying to get rid of all the fur she's just plucked. So a lot of you wonder, do leopards get hairballs? And of course they do. It looks like she's almost about to cough up one right now. I'm just listening to something. There's a strange noise. There's a cub here. I can hear it. Okay, so there is a cub here. I can just hear that little... And I can't see it yet, but it is somewhere in this little thicket. I can hear the little one. Okay, so the cubs are here. They're about 4 months old at the moment. They were born on the 1st of February 2016. So I think we're going to have to just sit here and wait patiently, and the cubs should hopefully pop out. So while we do that, let's go see Jamie, who's got another one of Africa's carnivores to show you.
I don't believe what's happening here. We've got two side-striped jackal chasing the black-backed jackal. The black-backed jackal's on the left, and there's the two side-striped. You can really see the difference in size, except I said that they're chasing it, but they're not really. This is such a fascinating interaction between two species that fill in the exact same ecological niche. Oh. Yep, can. There's the side striped. This is incredible. What a start to the afternoon. Karula calling her cubs. Both species of jackal. We're going to try and get round on the fire break. I'm hoping that they're just going to move off not too far away. We had them this morning on the sunrise safari, both species, trying to snatch scraps of that buffalo carcass from the hyenas. I can still see them. And we spoke about the interaction between side-striped and black-backed and the fact that they hardly ever come into any major kind of conflict, which is why this interaction was so interesting. There was no violence exactly, there was no overt aggression. It's just almost like the side-striped were pushing with their slight size advantage, and then of course the advantage of numbers as well. You can almost guarantee that's a male and a female side-striped jackal. It's anybody's guess what the black-back jackal is, whether it's a male or a female. Either way, this is really incredible interaction. We have been so spoiled today. This morning it was hyenas, jackals and vultures. This afternoon, it's two jackal species interacting for us. Try and speed up around this corner. We've just got to really keep our fingers crossed that they haven't disappeared into thick vegetation. Oh, I think I can see one there. They're sniffing around. There's obviously still scraps of the kill from this morning. That was originally the Nkuhuma's kill, then became the hyena's kill, and it now looks as though it is the jackal's. There's one side-striped just behind those trees there. And then there's the black-backed as well. It looks like the black-backed. What I can see. Yep, that's the black-backed. I wonder if it... I wonder if it's digging to lie down. And there you go. That's exactly what it did. And then there's the side striped. We're going to stick around and just watch this interaction a bit. While we do, back to Brent and Karula.
So she's pulled the carcass deeper into the thicket to get a bit of shade. And we still haven't managed to catch a sight of the cub yet. It's gone quiet again, but it is around. And at some point she might start calling to the cubs. So for her to have the best chance of actually successfully eating this whole kill, she's going to need to remove the stomach. Of course, that's a big, heavy part that she's not going to eat too much of. So undigested grass in the stomach. And then she will try, hopefully, hoist it into a tree nearby. Standing by. Copy, thanks. So just a little update from Jamie there. There's tracks of a male leopard coming in from Buffalo's Hook on top of our tracks from this morning. That could be Mr. Tingana. And they were heading in this general direction. Now, a male leopard will steal this kill from a female if he happens upon it. I think she's lucky. This isn't sort of on his normal route, but you never know with these leopards which way they might decide to go. So there's always a huge debate on the parental lineage of leopard and leopard cubs. So she mated with about four males that we know of, three males that we know of. She possibly could have mated with a few more. Now, she mates with lots of... There we go. Look, she's got into the chest cavity now. And so she'll mate with multiple males to all those males think they're the father. And that's to give the best possible chance for her cubs to survive if they encounter any of these males. So Jane is wondering, as we watch Karula dismember this impala, how long will a leopard feed on a kill for? Well, Jane, it's entirely dependent. They have no qualms eating highly rotten meat. So if she can get a kill this size into a tree, she'll happily feed off it for 3 or 4 days if it's big enough. But normally 2 to 3 days. So of course, one of the biggest threats to a female leopard having a carcass on the ground is hyenas. And a kudji is wondering how long till that carcass starts smelling and attracts the hyenas. Well, it depends. Probably in this winter weather where it's not too hot, it'll take a day or two. But if that stomach is opened, hyenas will pick up on that scent quite quickly. So what happens is leopard normally try... cover the stomach in sand to help mask that scent. And we might be lucky enough to watch her perform some of that behavior a little later. Hi, Monique. Monique is in London, and she's wondering, will Karula skin the impala to make it easier for the cubs to feed, or do they just instinctively know how to do that? Well, Monique, they do instinctively know how to do that, but she has already opened up the carcass, which will make it a little bit easier for them to feed. And the fact that they haven't eaten much on this carcass means that her and the cubs are pretty well fed at the moment. She's going to try probably eat the high mineral content organs next, liver, heart, lungs, kidneys as well. Liver is quite important for most of the big cats because of its very high iron content. See how she turns her head to the side using her premolars and molars to cut through the skin. There we go, she's doing it now. And we'll also use those to go through certain bones. There we go, she's pulling it closer towards us. And you can see the stomach start coming out on the left. And now she's opening up the stomach, or the outside of the stomach. There we go, you can see the intestines. Now she'll try, we can try to get to, as I said, those high value pieces of meat inside that impala. Also, once she's got the stomach and the intestines out, it will make it a lot easier for her to hoist this kill if she wants to. So she probably made this kill but maybe early this morning or late last night. And if you're wanting to ask any questions, like Monique and others have been doing about what we're looking at this very moment on a live African safari, you can do that by sending an email through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Those cubs haven't made another peep yet. They are definitely around here somewhere. As I said, her cubs haven't spent that much time with vehicles. So it's going to be a bit of a patience game at the moment. Just got to give them enough time to get used to our presence. So Lucy, hi Lucy, in South Bend, Indiana, is wondering whether there's a tree close by for Karula to hoist if she needs to. There are a couple, none of them are particularly ideal, but when you're being chased by hyenas, you don't go for ideal, you go for the closest. There's actually a nice marula tree up there. If she was going to hoist, it's going to be, we can't really see it, it's behind us. But there is a nice tree to hoist into, Lucy. Isn't this exciting? A Queen Karula of Juma Private Game Reserve. She's got an adult male impala, about a two-year-old, and we think her cubs are close by somewhere. I'm pretty sure, about 80% sure, I heard a cub calling a little earlier. So we're just going to sit tight here and hopefully they reveal themselves to us. The moment she's just opened the abdomen of the impala, feeding off some of the internal organs. Looks like she's feeding off a piece of the small intestine at the moment. Yep, plucking fur again. I'm still constantly scanning into the bushes around, trying to see if we can spot one of the little ones. Again, I can't see it. Yeah. So I'm just trying to figure out exactly where that little sound's coming from. I almost think it's coming from inside the thicket where she is, somewhere in this area. I'm just trying to check carefully. Quite often these little guys, we found them up in the trees as well. But it does sound like it might be coming down from directly underneath that sort of fallen log. Just trying to see any movement, but nothing yet. And it looks like she's got to some of the good bits. What's that she eating there? Nice and pink, could be some lungs, I can't really see. Nigel, who's in the UK, is wondering, when she eats so viciously, does she break any teeth? Not so much break as wear down, Nigel. When they break teeth, it's normally in the actual killing or fighting. Those are the two more common times when they break their teeth. When feeding like this, less likely. In older animals, it is possible, but again, still less likely. I'm just trying to... Is that... Take it my binoculars quickly. Or my camera maybe might be a better option. I think I see something. Just trying to... A light's quite difficult. And you get into that... The depths of that bush. Oh, no, she's moved now. I can't really... Maybe not. Whatever I saw has moved. So we're starting to smell the carcass now. Not too bad, it's quite a fresh carcass. You know, sort of the smell of undigested grass from that impala's stomach. plucking. That's just bumping the branch there. Whole bush is moving. I don't know if you guys can hear that. Well, imagine having all that hair in your mouth. Not very pleasant. She might just change position. She might even move the carcass a little bit. Sorry guys, I'm being quiet. I'm just trying to listen, I'm trying to pinpoint where this noise is coming from. Little monsters hiding. So I think I hear something bigger coming through. There might be some elephants moving in behind us. I can't see them yet. I just every now and then just hear a branch breaking. So leopards will often feed for a while and then they will stop and snooze and digest that meat that they've got. But we're going to keep our eye out around here and hopefully we are able to figure out where the sound is coming from and we will see those little guys. But while we do that, Jamie's got some pachyderms for you.
Well, we just had to show you this elephant before she disappears. Because she is absolutely bulging. Look at that. Oh, that is one, I was going to say very pregnant, but being pregnant is one of those things you either are or you aren't. You can't be very pregnant, but you kind of know what I mean. Just look at that. She looks like she's absolutely ready to burst. In fact, I think she's actually incredibly uncomfortable because she was, compared to the rest of the herd that are perfectly relaxed, she was actually a little bit stressed out when we came through, and I think feeling a bit uncomfortable and very, very vulnerable in the condition that she's in. We'll try sneak forward. Obviously, I'm not going to try and follow her into the bushes. So she has largely moved off. No, I'm not going to try. It's going to be next to impossible. The rest of the herd is in there as well to give her some support. Not the terribly clearest view of an elephant we've ever had. I'm just going to take my earpiece out for 1 second. Oh, it's just babblers. I thought I heard monkeys alarm calling, but it's just the arrow-marked babbler, a very noisy type of bird. Okay. Unfortunately, our elephants have now moved back into the bushes and they're very, very difficult to see. We're not going to try and follow them just because that female is so incredibly pregnant, and I don't want to stress her out in any way, shape or form. They are moving straight down towards the Juma Pan. So at some point, I know that the camera has been offline for a while. I'm not sure if it's working yet. Our tech team have been working on it. But at some point, there is a good chance that they're going to pop out at the Juma Dam and go and have a drink. So you can keep an eye out for the pregnant elephant then. I'm not going to try and follow her and cause her any additional stress. Going to start making our way more resolutely now. We've been seriously sidetracked, but we're going to start making our way more resolutely towards Cheetah Plains and Inkanyeni. I didn't think it was terribly polite to turn up out of the blue right outside a guest room before they go out on game drive. Somehow I think that they might have taken serious offense to that. It's just not good manners. So we've been giving them time to rouse themselves, have their afternoon coffee with Amarula or whatever else that they're going to grab, and then to head out on game drive before we arrive on their doorstep. And of course to give them a chance to see her as well. I bumped into the guests who are staying in the room. She's killed something in the riverbed right outside their bedroom. I mean, right outside. They'll be able to look down at her. He does, doesn't he? Oh no. Sorry about that. Rusty not firing on all cylinders, quite literally. But he really does. That was the best description that VM just came up with. Our male impala here has most definitely sporting the scars. Hey boy, how's the rutting season going for you? Look at him, shame. Oh, puffy, swollen eye, injuries all over his face. That's exactly what he looks like for him. He looks like he's been in a bar fight. And of course, the male impala are all looking a little bit the worse for the wear. Oh, his left side's okay. His opponent obviously managed to get in on the right and get to his face. It is mating season for the impala. It's slowly drawing to a close, actually, over the next few weeks, but they have been furiously fighting each other to get hold of a harem of females, a temporary harem. Impala don't have a permanent harem, but a temporary harem that they will then keep with them and defend from other males. And he's clearly, I'm saying he's come off second best. Well, first of all, we haven't seen the other guy, but also he might have been defending a harem for 7-8 days straight until he was absolutely exhausted and just didn't have the energy to do it anymore, and then got pushed out and taken over by the next male. And in that way, it keeps the impala genetics fresh, so you don't find that just one of them is mating with all of the females. They exhaust themselves, and then the next one comes along. I think we'll leave our poor battered impala. He'll be absolutely fine, just by the way. I don't even think his eye is damaged. It looks sore, it looks puffy and swollen, but I don't think it's going to be like Nelson. Nelson, the one-horned, one-eyed impala, definitely was far worse off. So I think our impala gentleman's going to be absolutely fine. Let's head back over to Brent, because I know that there will be other vehicles wanting to join that sighting. So let's enjoy our time with Karula while we can.
So no change here. Oh yeah, with the queen, and she's still eating this impala. Now there's still some little birds alarm calling a little way off, and I'm hoping that's where the cubs are. I'm just going to sit here patiently to see what happens. So this impala kill was found by Tuxin and Fanucci from Juma's Vuyatela Lodge this morning. When they found it, there was no leopard here, but as you can see, now there is. So whether she went off to fetch the cubs, or maybe just went for a drink of water. Now, if the cubs were a real long way away, she might not even bring them through. And I'm just trying to wonder what I heard. I'm pretty sure it's a cub about 80%, but not 100%. We're just going to have to reposition slightly because Tuxin's on his way. And since he found it, it's only fair that he can come enjoy this magnificent sighting as well. So, watch out. Little terminalia tree. I'm just trying to think how the best way to position to fit two vehicles in here. Out the tree. Oh, it's stuck now. Oh, another thorn tree. Let's just do that. That should make life a little bit easier. Okay, there should be enough space for both of us now. She's right in that abdominal cavity at the moment, getting to a nice rich in mineral organs. Yeah, can I try? Firm taxi, just come to my left. I've made some space for you here. There we go, the Juma guests are coming to enjoy Queen Karula with us. Just watching the next vehicle come in. Hi, Joyce. Joyce is in New Hampshire. Joyce is wondering, why would Karula bring her babies to a fresh kill that's not in a tree? Surely it'd be very dangerous. Well, Joyce, those babies are already eating meat, and they're able to climb trees. So she would definitely bring the cubs to a kill on the ground. I'm just going to have a quick word with taxi. I think the Mampimpan are here. I heard that down that side where those birds are alarm calling. You hear those tip, 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 tip. So I think they're around. There we go, she's still feeding off the small intestine. There we go, you saw the droppings drop out there. So she will feed off the outer parts of the intestine, obviously not the undigested grass and dung inside the intestines. So it's been quite a while since we've had a nice long sighting of Karula. She's been doing some disappearing acts across our southern boundary, but wonderful to have her back deep inside Juma. So the light is a bit difficult. She's right in the deep shade with sun behind her. Alice in Oregon is wondering, what is the survival rate of the cubs? So as with a lot of big cats, Alice, there's a mortality rate of 75%. So only 25% of the cubs ever survive. And out of the known cub mortalities, about 70% of those cub mortalities are caused by male leopards, either dominant male leopards that she hasn't mated with, or by nomadic dispersal male leopards. And the other 30% is made up of hyenas, possibly even another female leopard, python I know of killing leopard cubs, jackal I know of killing leopard cubs, buffalo I know of killing leopard cubs. So it is a very tough world out here in the African bush. But this particular female is a very good mother, and she's raised most of her litters, or at least one of the two cubs she's had normally, to adulthood. Hi, Kathy. Kathy's in Tennessee. Kathy would like to know, is hunting a learnt behavior, or is it something that comes naturally to the cubs? Well, Kathy, it comes naturally. And Kathy would also like to know, what age do they first start hunting? I think the earliest recorded adult impala kill I know of by a leopard cub was 5 months. So even at this very young age, they'll be chasing birds, squirrels, lizards, monitor lizards, all around. So they're developing those skills, but the instinct to catch and chase is born. It's not taught. This is incredibly special. We're sitting here on a live African safari, mere feet away from a female leopard devouring a young male impala. And if you would like to know anything about what we're seeing on screen, please drop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So Ellen in North Dakota says, it looks like she's sniffing before tasting. Do all the big cats do that? Ellen, I don't really think she's sniffing. She's quite aware of what's in there. I think she might just be getting either hair or blood or whatnot on her nose, and she's just trying to get rid of it. She looks like she's drinking some of the blood. deeper into the shade. There we go. Now, there's a couple of reasons for that. Because she could be getting a little bit warm and that sun's setting. So the sun is directly behind her. The other reason is she might be worried that it's being seen by potential scavengers such as vultures. And when vultures start dropping, the lions and hyenas watch carefully and could be following very shortly. Now, I haven't heard any cub-like noises for a while. So, while we wait to see what happens here with the Queen of Juma, let's jump back on board with Jamie and probably the creature that most leopard cubs rack up as their first kill.
Whoa, John. John sent us through an update about a leopard or a lion sneaking past on the Juma Dam camera, and I've come through straight to the scene to investigate, and I've located two witnesses. I've been attempting to ask them, but at the moment they've both clammed up and they won't tell me which way it went and they won't tell me what it was. But a very big thank you, John, for sending through that update. Just heard about it now, so I have come across to the Juma Dam camera to investigate, and I've located two tree squirrels, one of whom is pretending that we haven't seen it, or hoping that we haven't seen it, and actually what I think it's doing is basking. In fact, I think both of them are basking in the late afternoon sunlight. Unlike squirrels in the northern hemisphere, our tree squirrels don't hibernate in any way. They don't have to stockpile food, but they do have to eat as much as possible during the summer months. Oh, are you going back to where we first saw you? The squirrel really enjoys this really fragile looking branch. Feels as though it might be the wrong place for it to settle. Looks as though it could break at any second. Not actually that I have ever seen a tree squirrel fall, misjudge, or in any way show a lack of coordination or climbing skills. Right to the tip. It feels like a very risky decision. And it really does look as though it's been spying on whatever's going on around it, keeping a close eye on the comings and goings of the various cat species. And of course, tree squirrels, one of the first animals to sound the alarm when something like a bird of prey or a snake or a slender mongoose or indeed a leopard or a lion comes past in a sort of cackling, almost witch's laugh type sound. It does really genuinely sound like they are laughing at you when they alarm call. I don't know if these squirrels spotted anything, John. I have checked for the tracks and I'm going to keep looking. While I look, Brent is still with Karula and she's up and about.
So here we go, she's finished feeding now. After she pulled that carcass a little bit deeper into the bush, she's come out and she's giving herself a good clean. Now, the one thing that might make me think that the cubs aren't here is the fact that she's not chuffing or calling to them. They might be here, they might just be being a little nervous. So you hear that click in the background, that's me taking a few photographs. So we encourage you to get some screenshots, share them on our Facebook page, Safari Live, or share them on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. leopards are quite fastidious groomers, so constantly licking, cleaning. But even though they do clean a lot, they still actually are quite dirty animals, even though they don't look like it. Inundated with lots of ticks, fleas, and other parasites. Isn't she beautiful? And you can see those long, long whiskers. They're called vibrissae. And they are such incredibly beautiful things. Much, much longer than a domestic cat's whiskers. You'll notice that sort of round motion, very similar domestic cat. That very round lick, paw lick. Now, David in Houston would like to know, does a leopard carry its same name once it crosses over different reserve boundaries? Generally, yes. Most of the time, the animal will be referred to by the same name as it moves through between the different lodges. So we are having such a spectacular sighting of her. There are other vehicles who are going to be coming in here shortly, so we're going to make space for them. And if there's a chance before sunset, we will come back. If not, we won't be coming here after dark because that kill is on the ground and the smart hyenas of the Sabi Sands have learnt to follow spotlights to leopard kills. But anyway, we're gonna be moving on from here now. So while we do that, let's go across to Jamie.
Do have a little bit of a mystery on our hands here as to whether, first of all, whether or not John saw a leopard or a lion walking past the elephants on the Juma Dam camera this morning. Apparently, it was very sneaky. But also whether or not it was Karula. The reason I say that is it's just interesting that she doesn't seem to have her cubs with her, yet she left the kill this morning, disappeared off, and then came back once again. Very curious as to why that was, what distracted her. Because, I mean, the immediate thought is that she would have gone to go and fetch her cubs and then come back. But she doesn't seem to have them with her. And it makes me think, or at least wonder, whether or not it ties into the animal that John saw. I've been checking Central Road, which is the usual pathway that the cats take when they're making their way towards the Juma Pan, or at least the lions take. The leopards tend to be a bit often wandering off the beaten track. The lions seem to enjoy wandering along this road. And just bear with me one second. Just to hear Cheetah Plains update about the leopard that we were looking at. And it sounds as though the guys finally managed to have a good look at her. And apparently, it wasn't in Kanyeni. Apparently, it was Tundi. So it just goes to show, we never had a proper look at her. we sort of struggled through the drainage line. And apparently, for those of you who were watching the sunrise safari, it was Tundi, not in Kanyeni, that we saw this morning. Just an update on that side. Sorry about that. It was obviously a case of miscommunication, and we could never get a good enough view in order to see her properly. So it was Tundi, not in Kanyeni, that was outside the Cheetah Plains Lodge, and from what it sounds like, she may have disappeared. I just want to double check that with Mike. Mike for Jamie. Mike, sorry, what was the update on Tundi? It's a lion log. Copy that. Thanks very much, Mike. Okay, so she has disappeared. Andrew's been trying to find her and hasn't had any success. And because we're having fireside chat tonight and we have to get the vehicles back on time, I think that will change our plans for the afternoon. I don't think we're going to go racing across to Cheetah Plains today. Standing by, Brent. Brent just wants to chat to me quickly. Copy that, thank you. And an update from Brent. Apparently the animal that John saw was not a leopard, but a lioness. And it was that single lioness from this morning. She moved across to the west. Taxon and his guests actually saw her. So that's what Brent and myself were just discussing. That does explain exactly what's been going on. She's probably looking for the rest of her pride. What's there, Via? Mongoose. Oh, wonderful. I'm trying to find, I can't see them at all. Have they run away from me? Like they've all gone to ground. I was busy looking in the other direction. So VM spotted some dwarf mongoose. But I'm sure that we'll find you some others. This lot appear to be quite shy. The interesting thing is that the different groups of mongoose tend to be either comfortable with vehicles or particularly shy. It's usually those around the main roads, the regularly driven roads, that are quite content and quite comfortable with the presence of people and the presence of vehicles. I have seen banded mongoose before on this road, in this area, and banded mongoose is a species of mongoose that we hardly ever manage to get on camera. They're exceptionally shy when compared to their slightly smaller cousins, the dwarf mongoose. They are around. I've seen them once or twice and I've got them on camera once. And only once. They just don't stick around, so that's something to keep an eye out for as well. But yes, that lioness has crossed west from the pan, so that's the opposite direction to where we are going, and is moving. So Brent's going to be checking around that area to see if he can't follow up. I think she might be trying to relocate on the rest of the pride. Oh, Ian spotted my favorite, or one of my top five favorite raptors. I'm just really hoping they're gonna stay. There's two of them. Please stay, please stay, please stay. Okay, that's gonna be, I think, the best view without scaring them. We've got the pair of African hawk eagles that nest here. And as I said, they are one of my top five favorite raptors. I couldn't tell you why. I don't know whether it's their appearance. They're slightly mottled. It's the white combined with that dark brown. But it's also, I think it's the fact that you always see them in pairs. And here we go. Injecting the byproducts of digestion. So this pair of African hawk eagles actually nests not far from where we are here. And they are highly specialized bird hunters. With lots of white underneath their wings and underneath their bellies. So this is one of them. The second African hawk eagle is down and to the right of it. Unfortunately, there's nowhere I can put Viam that he can actually see it. It's kind of hidden. One will be hidden and the other will be hidden. There we go. We've got a view through the leaves. You just might have got a glimpse of that bright orange eye if you were looking quick enough. I said that they're specialized bird hunters, in particular Franklins and guinea fowl, and they work together as a team, the mated pairs. Like all birds of prey, they mate for life, and they develop, unlike most birds of prey, they hunt together, one flying high and one flying low, and then sharing the kills between the two of them. And they've just been spotted by a squirrel. The one's taken off, which is why there was that instant response from the squirrels around us. Alarm calling, letting everything know that there is an aerial predator flying about. I wouldn't be surprised if the second one follows shortly. I double checked on their breeding season, because the last time I saw them in this area, one of them was carrying a stick. Looked as though it was going to start adding to their nest, which is just inside this block. And they've got another 2 or so months before they start to lay their eggs, roughly. Now the female will be bulking up. And the male will be helping her prepare the nests. If you have a look at the true sign of an eagle, every now and again you'll be able to see that this African hawk eagle has feathers all the way down its legs. Very important identifying feature of the true eagles versus other birds of prey. And we do have several different species of birds of prey. James Richards, you were wondering about if there is a sort of a level success rate amongst all of the different raptors, or if some have more success in terms of hunting than others, and does that change in terms of migratory patterns, seasons, food availability, but mainly with some eagles migrating backwards and forwards? It's a very good question. You know, we compare our predators all the time. We talk about the success rates and the relative success rates of lions, leopards, cheetah, hyena, wild dog. We never really think about our aerial predators and their success rates. And I actually couldn't be able to tell you which birds of prey are more successful than others. Of course, the Wahlberg's eagles are missing throughout our winter period, as are the steppe buzzards, the steppe eagles, the Amur falcons. Lots of different birds start to migrate, or have migrated already, actually. There he goes. I'm going to think about James's bird question in the meantime. Brent has found one of our other feathered friends.
So, Jamie was just chatting about raptors, and here we have a raptor that's being escorted by a large flock of grey hornbills that are not happy with its presence. And I'm going to let you tell me which raptor this is. So, here we go, the hornbills are not happy. There's a huge flock of them around him, as well as the obligatory fork-tailed drongo. Now, there we go, you can hear the grey hornbills shouting. And there's a fork-tailed drongo. Two fork-tailed drongos. So I think when this poor eagle flies, it's going to get bombarded. Now, if you know, and you're one of our avid birders here on Safari Live, which raptor this is, let me know. And you can do that by sending an email to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Now, the diagnostic features, you want to look at its legs. And in this particular case, it's eye color. And even from this distance, we can see that eye color sticking out quite profusely. I'm going to try sneak a little bit closer. Just wanted to make sure you got a safety of that beautiful raptor before we moved any closer. So it's amazing. We've got all these other birds that are really uncomfortable with the presence of this raptor. So they're keeping an eye on it, even though this bird doesn't really hunt other birds. Okay, is this going to be... don't fly, please don't fly. How's that, Dave? Oh no, it's going to fly. It's one of those things. Okay, let's see if we can catch up. It hasn't landed too far away. Landed on top of a rain tree or an apple leaf. And we might be able to get a bit closer without having to sort of pop out from under a tree. Go. Oh no, off it goes again. Okay, let's stop harassing the poor creature. And lots of grey hornbills. They're following it. Poor guy. He's being seriously mobbed by all these hornbills. There they go, after him. And so apparently, and I would like our Juma Cam aficionados to let me know what happened. Apparently, a lioness arrived at the Juma Cam during the day. And I think we did have a power out, so there might have been no power at the dam cam. So we're going to go look. The lioness apparently went west from the pan itself. So I'm doing just a quick check around here before I'm going to head a little bit more west. I think she might be following the edge of a steep line hunting. And it's the Nkuruma lioness who does have the cubs. Unfortunately, we got really excited this morning. We thought she was bringing the cubs to Juma, but she did leave them still to the east of our boundary. Also, I heard some elephants down in this area earlier, so let's see if we can catch up with them while we check foot tracks of that lioness. And of course, any fantastic creature we might come across, such as that mystery eagle. I'm waiting for you to tell me what it is. Hi, Peter in Germany. Peter would like to know, do the raptors kill their prey with their beak or their talons? It depends. Sometimes a combination of both, but generally the talons are the most important things because they will hit whatever their prey species at normally at quite high speed with those vicious talons of theirs. Jamie. I'm just going to get a hold of Jamie quickly, see what area she's working to make sure we don't double check the same areas. No, false alarm, stick. Lovely, lovely late or early winter's afternoon. Not a cloud in the sky. And of course, don't forget fireside chat. And we will be doing fireside chat a little bit differently to what we've ever done it before. And it is going to be 15 minutes later. So Fireside Chat will only be 15 minutes today, and it will be on Facebook Live. So if you want to join us for Fireside Chat this evening, go onto the Safari Live Facebook page. And I think there's a little notification button on there that'll tell you when there's a live broadcast coming from that page. And we will be doing it from the Facebook page. So quite interesting, trying something a little bit new. And it will only be on Facebook. It will not be on the other streams at the same time. So Raisa, Joanne and Alice, you guys are spot on. It was a brown snake eagle with that diagnostic orange eye and the bare legs. So while we continue to see if we can find any tracks of that lioness and those elephants I heard a little earlier, let's go see how Jamie's doing in the east of the reserve.
Well, Brent, searches the western sector. We are searching the eastern side of Juma. By the sounds of things, it's getting more and more tricky to catch you guys out on things like birds, and I know for certain that it's getting more and more tricky to catch you out on tracks. We'll have to work a little bit harder, but at least that means that we're doing our job right. I've also got tracks of a lioness, by the way, but I'm fairly certain that this is from this morning, where Brent had her right at the end of the sunrise safari. And I suspect that it's the same lioness that then walked past the Juma Dam and the Juma Pan. But just in case, we're going to head up north to Buffleshoek Dam and double check around there, make sure that there isn't a sneaky lion or something else having a drink around the dam. It's been nice and warm this afternoon. Very pleasant weather at this time of year, apart from first thing in the morning where we shiver our way through. The weather during the day is exceptionally comfortable. So always the chance of Gijima. We haven't seen him since that incredible time that Brent got to spend with him. Gijima is a male leopard that has started pushing into this area, as far as we can tell, the northern side of Juma, which is actually the northern part of the main dominant male in this area, Tingana's territory. And this particular leopard is exceptionally skittish. He's not used to cars. We think that he might be a Kruger leopard, or from even further afield, somewhere where he hasn't grown up with vehicles coming up and down and around him throughout his life. In complete contrast to, say, Karula's cubs or Inkanyeni's cubs. Brent spent some time with him when he had a kill in this area. He's much more relaxed at night, which is generally the pattern with skittish animals. Leopards, serval, caracal, all tend to be a bit more relaxed at night when there is with a spotlight. But he got comfortable enough to let Brent get a good view of him. there's always the possibility that he is around and starting to get more and more used to the constant backwards and forwards of vehicles. I think I've just spotted a cat log again.
A catalog.
No, it's I don't think that's anything. It's on the right of the termite mound, at the base of that thorn tree, and I think not even a log. What is it? It's like a combination of spider web and grass. Got cats on the brain. You never know. Could have been a wild cat. It's happened before, but it wasn't in that case. Not quite as bad as the poor Dacre that I thought convinced myself was some kind of mystery cat hiding behind the bush one night. Oh, James Richard, I was thinking about your question, by the way, about the efficiency of bird hunters. And I was thinking about the fact that we don't get to observe them as much as we get to observe leopards or lions hunting. It's just that much more difficult to witness a bird hunt. Now, I know that black eagles, Varroa eagles, their old name is black eagles, they're now called Varroa eagles, which we don't really see in this area because they're much better adapted to the more rocky areas, mountainous areas. But I know that they have an incredibly high success rate in terms of their hunting ability. They tend to ambush their prey at great speed, and because they're a very heavy eagle, they're the second largest eagle that we get here in terms of weight. Because they're a very large eagle, they tend to have an incredible impact when they do hit their prey. I've heard that they have very high success rates in terms of hunting ability. I was also thinking about secretary birds and ground hornbills, funnily enough. But I think that we see, or at least I have a mental picture of them having a high success rate because they forage on the ground, so we can watch them more effectively than we might something else. But I really honestly don't know the answer to what birds might be more efficient as hunters or have a higher success rate as hunters than others. I've seen them all try and miss, but that applies to every species. They can't be successful all of the time. And even now, I can hear a Franklin alarm calling. He stopped though, so I think it was just a little bit of a fright. Last time Viam and I saw a bird hunt here, it was the most incredible sighting. It was with an African goshawk, if I'm not mistaken, that had caught a Franklin and was trying to pluck it so that it could feed on it. But it was being mobbed constantly by grey go-away birds. The most phenomenal sighting. That was late one evening as we were coming across towards Biffleshoek Dam. Peter from the Netherlands, you were wondering whether our snake eagles or large birds of prey can hunt at night, and the answer is no, they can't. Unless it is a full moon night where you might see a little bit more activity, it is very, very unusual to see them active at night. Their eyesight is not good at night. We arrived at Biffleshoek Dam, currently inhabited by its grumpiest inhabitant. Just to finish off Peter's question before we chat about the hippo at Biffleshoek Dam. Peter, the nocturnal hunting is left solely for the owls to do. None of the other birds of prey have that level of eyesight. I called this hippo grumpy. That's probably highly unfair. First of all, he makes a very pleasant island for the terrapins of the area. They very often spend time hitching a ride on his back, and he's perfectly tolerant of them. And he's not grumpy, it's not his fault. He is exceptionally defensive, but all of the hippos are feeling pressurized at the moment by the drought that we're experiencing. And as the water levels get lower and lower, So they find themselves under more and more pressure. And I've noticed it particularly with him. He immediately starts showing what's known as displacement behavior. It's not quite aggression, although he has shown aggression before, or threat displays. But the snorting of the air out of his nostrils, all of that is just signs of him letting us know that we absolutely must not come any closer to him. He defends this, as it is one of the last remaining big dams. And as the hippo become more and more stressed out by the drought, they become more under pressure. Buffalo weavers chirping away. Chirp, chirp, chirp. We got asked a question about a white-headed buffalo weaver actually the other day, and I realized I never finished answering it. I can't remember who it was. We got distracted by something, but one of the viewers asked whether or not we get white-headed buffalo weavers here, and I never finished answering. The answer is no, we don't. They only really occur in eastern Africa, so it's Kenya, Tanzania side. The only buffalo weaver we have here is the red-billed buffalo weaver. Constantly busy little birds, building those incredibly messy nests of theirs. And as always, around Buffalo's Hook Dam, its usual cohort of starlings. In this case, what looks like it's a greater blue-eared starling. With its glorious incandescent sheen. One of those typical patterns where the pretty birds don't really have the most attractive of calls. Funny sound. Oh. And we have our first visitor to the dam this afternoon. A young waterbuck bull has come to drink. Always tense and coiled when you see antelope and zebra drink. That constant instinctive awareness that the murky water could be hiding something far more sinister than a grumpy hippo bull. And even though we haven't seen crocodiles in this dam for a long, long time, does not mean that it's impossible that there is one. I don't think there is, but you never ever take that for granted in Africa. While we look at one of our most common antelope, Jesse was wondering about a rarer antelope of a much larger size. Now, Jesse, you were saying that you've heard that the sable might come on to Juma as we're faced with this drought, and you were wondering whether or not, or whether there are any other rare species of antelope that we might see. Oh, we've got something interesting playing out. Sorry. Jesse, I will get back to your question. I suddenly noticed the change in the hippo's behavior, and that's why. Look, this standoff. Young male elephant, thirsty young male elephant, and our hippo friend. Oh, terrapin's gone sliding off. Really, hippo? He's definitely bigger than that. Well, no, he's not bigger than that elephant, but that elephant is not that much bigger than him, weight-wise. And I think the Ellie is going to come and try and drink from the other side of the dam. Oh, we do not want to be involved in a battle between the two leviathans of the bush. Oh, head shake. And we'll make sure that we are ready to leave at a moment's notice, let's put it that way. He's such a thirsty elephant. He he was not going to be deterred by the actions of that hippo. And now the hippo, I think, is a lot of bluster. Here we go. He was so thirsty, he was not interested in being bullied. And the hippos are, when it comes to elephants and that kind of situation, I think a lot more bark than bite. The same does not apply to human beings, and they are to be treated with the utmost of respect. Rumored to be the biggest killer of any number of people in Africa, which isn't really a fair comparison, because hippos live in water and human beings build their homes and their settlements near water. So it automatically puts them at risk of hippo attacks, getting between a hippo and water. That, combined with the fact that I don't know that we know exactly how many people are killed by crocodiles every year in Africa. I'm talking about the mammal, not the mosquito, before anybody wants to suggest that. I do know that mosquitoes are more responsible for more deaths than any other animal. Well, you won that battle, Ellie. You can enjoy your drink. Now, if our young elephant bull had some company, if he were with a herd and if there were some other young males with him, he might be a little bit more confident in terms of his approach to that hippo's sort of flag in the ground moment. Each trunkful between, probably with an elephant of this size, between 8 to 10 liters of water. And he's having a big drink. Might even have been his first drink of the day. The Fossok Dam is not what I would call pristine at this point. It's become very muddied and quite sullied by the combination of the hippo and the buffalo. At this point, it is one of the few water sources left for a lot of the animals. Really, you can watch him stretch his trunk away from the edge so that he doesn't get a trunk full of sandy water that's been disturbed from where he's standing. He's trying to reach out as far as possible. He might even have decided to go for a swim if that hippo hadn't very clearly told him that that would not be acceptable. Look at him, trunk and mouth full of water. Beautiful scene here at Buffalshoek Dam. I'm going to tear your eyes away from the hippo-elephant drama for one moment and just point out a bird that we don't often see. They've been calling around me the whole time we've been watching the sighting, demanding that I show them some attention. There you go. African green pigeons for you. You don't often get to see them out on dead trees like this. What's it called again in Afrikaans? Oh, it's a papegaaidief. A parrot dove. Papegaaidief. One of my favorite Afrikaans names for the birds. Some of them are just better, like the spookfool, the ghost bird for the grey-headed bushrike. It can be very literal in terms of naming things. Afrikaans language. Oh, and joined by a Cape turtle dove. A pigeon, generally a fruit eater and usually arboreal when compared to a dove, which is a seed eater mainly and largely ground-based. So whilst they might rest in trees, they spend most of their time wandering about in the ground. Although they're part of the same larger group, larger family, you can very clearly see the difference in terms of, first of all, size between the birds, second of all, the colour approach. Most doves are relatively somber coloured, greys, subtle browns, don't really want to draw attention to themselves, whilst the green pigeons, as their name suggests, bright green with just a hint of blue around the shoulders. Lovely birds. Our elephant is still hanging around Buffelshoek Dam. He's thought a little bit about antagonizing the hippo, but for the moment neither of them want to risk a confrontation, and so he's decided that in the interests of being prudent he's going to leave now. But you see that little lift of the foot, the backward glance? That's a sign of elephant indecision. Kind of like he was thinking about going back to show the hippo who's boss, and he certainly didn't want the hippo to think that he had been chased away. He wants the hippo to know that he is leaving on his own terms. It's a very anthropomorphic very anthropomorphic interpretation of what is happening. But it's so easy to do that with elephants, because they're just, they give you that opportunity and they kind of make it that way. So he has moved off. Peter, in Germany, you were wondering on the subject of our aquatic life at the dam, what kind of fish would live here? The answer is tilapia would be one. And at this point, I think most of the tilapia have died off. At this point, probably one of the only remaining fish is the catfish or the barbel. The reason I say that is at one point this year, Peter, this dam was dry. I mean bone dry. Most of the fish died. It became exceptionally smelly and somewhat hazardous to walk around, because you'd sink into mud and wind up slicing yourself on the bits of fish bone around it. The catfish have a very useful adaptation where they go down into the mud and they cover themselves with a mucus layer that keeps them protected. So there might well still be some catfish that have survived the dryness of the dam. Jesse, I still haven't finished answering your question. I'm going to try and do it quickly. Sable is the most likely. Sable actually used to be based in this area. There's a possibility of roan, there's a possibility of antelope and tsetsebe, and maybe even Sharpe's Graysbok. But the sable is one of the most likely that you might see out here, just because roan is so much rarer. A bird just landed on our antenna. Okay, well, he's gone now. Apparently it's most convenient. Our elephant has moved off, and I think that Brent has found some more to show you.
We're getting inspected by a little bull elephant. He's, oh, you're going to do a turn around? He got a little bit scared, went a bit too far from mum. But I think might get some more bravery shortly and come back to inspect us again. So we're right on the northwestern corner of Juma at the moment. And it sounds like there's quite a big herd of elephants around us. We've got those two in front of us, and there's some more off to the left. Oh, there we go. Here he comes. There we go. Look at that. He's going to charge right up to the car. Isn't that amazing? Look at that little one. Then run back to mom. Dave can't even help giggle. Isn't that just the sweetest thing you've ever seen? Now, very common little elephant bull behavior. He's just trying to show us how big and tough he is. But he doesn't want to get too far from mom. But that was absolutely wonderful. Okay, so we were using our VR rig. I'm just going to do a little clap, safety clap for sinking. And then we're going to turn it off and see if we can move closer to these elephants. That was wonderful. There we go. That was absolutely spectacular. Now, of course, when that happens and it's a big bull who weighs 6 tons, it's a little bit more intimidating. Oh, I'm just going to move very slowly, always when you go into a breeding herd. It's always good to move nice and slowly. And we don't want to upset the apple cart, so to speak. And let's see if we can get another view of the cheeky little youngster. So there we go. Oh, we're going to get another little inspection, a little bit better light. So if you hear some snapping, it's just my camera. It's just too cute not to. Oh, we're getting a little bit from a slightly older one now. Hello, madam, young female. It's more curiosity and a bit of playfulness rather than any actual aggression. So when it comes to elephant breeding herds, you always watch the adults. There we go, look at this. Maybe we should do another VR day. She's going to move off. We'll give it a go.
Rolling.
Okay, I'm going to do the clap at the end. Look at this. So we're getting some nice elephant activity here. These little ones are playing with us, shaking their heads at us. And quite often, watch as she walks away, she's not, and will suddenly swing around. No, I think she's bored of us now. But it doesn't mean that little guy over there is not going to. So you can see the mother completely relaxed, tail just swinging. Here we go, here it comes. There we go. Hello, little monster. Yes, you're very brave and very scary. No, I'm trying to decide, half, should I stay with mom? Should I tell them off? That little guy's probably about 5-6 months. No, it's going to go back to mom. So they're going to move into a thicket there. There's some more ellies slightly out in the open behind us. So I think we'll go have a look at those. Maybe try one more view of the little cheeky youngster. You can see. Pop my nose off here. They are feeding in this direction, so hopefully they feed towards us. It's getting us into a good spot. Oh, here he comes. When you put it in gear. But I think the novelty of our arrival has worn off a bit. Hello. A young female. You're also scary, madam. And if you look at her tail, she's quite fine, just a bit of playfulness. Oh, that's going to be beautiful. If that big female kicks up some dust, it's going to be lovely light. Just going to roll back. Oh, looks like they're going to go into the sunset. Oh, there's a bigger herd coming through. Let me just try getting to the bright spot. Dave, I reckon we pop that VR on again. Okay, I'm just going to do a clap before we get close to the ellies. So, there we go. So there's a nice big herd of elephants here. They're coming out of the crest here, through out of the more closed woodland into a far more open woodland, and we just got this gorgeous light coming through as the sun sets to the west. And I'm just going to try to get us into a good spot to see all the elephants. So there's elephants there, there, all the way around us here. Oh, hello, it's you from this morning. Okay, I recognize that cow at the back. She's sometimes a little bit iffy, but she looks like she's calmed down now. But we might get some action from the little guys. There's one behind us as well, going past. Just we're literally now 360 degrees elephants around us. Now these youngsters might come a bit closer to investigate us. There you go. Another young female stepping out. Oh, there you go, head shake. Oh, look, 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 coming right up on our nose. Hello, mister. The sun behind. Well, Peter, who's in Germany, is wondering, do we have any Amarula trees on Juma? And that tree right there, Peter, is an Amarula tree that the elephants are underneath. Isn't it? Move the vehicle again slightly. Always important to let your vehicle run a little bit before you move. Sometimes, and keep your revs very low. Sometimes high revving and things like that can be sometimes misconstrued by the elephants as an aggressive movement. Hello, mister. Another little boy shaking his head at us. And this female, I'm going to continue eating the bush willow in front of us. And that's just amazing. So Pinky Swear in Michigan is wondering, do you little baby elephants? Sorry, I'm not looking at you because I'm looking at the VR. So it's a bit awkward now, we're trying to do both. But Pinky Swear is wondering, do elephants learn how to charge from their mom, or is it instinctual behavior? It's probably a bit of both. They'll gauge the reactions of the other animals in the herd and then react accordingly. You can see how breaking up that little bush willow there. But let's wait. She's listening. She almost looks at, no, she's decided to eat now. Like she was listening to us. Now most of the herd has moved away. We just put the one female now. She's right in front of us. The others disappearing to the north towards Buffalo's Hook. There we go. I think we're going to leave these ellies now, let them continue on their nightly meanders. You can see there's the little cheeky elephant from as we started. It was just wonderful, that little one. Gave us a good talking to you, it did. Let's not wait for this female in front of us to finish feeding before we move on. Ah, she's using her tusks to break through. There we go. She's coming through now. Hello. I've seen you before in the last 2 days. I recognize that broken left tusk of hers. Very distinct. You can see that sort of wear inside it. Yes. How are you today, madam? Enjoying your bush willow? Looks like she is. Now, we've had some wonderful little sightings of elephants today. On the sunrise safari, we actually had a little elephant throw a stick at us. And these are being a little bit more civil. Now watch how she turns that. Oh, she says she's going to break it this time. But she uses her trunk and she's going to turn that branch through her mouth. And what she's doing there is removing the cambium layer from the base of that branch. That's the area that's got a lot of nutrients. She's not really eating too much of it. So, oh, there we go. She's got a whole piece. It's lovely when they do that. So completely relaxed in our presence. Trying to see if there's any little morsel left. Oh, there we go. So she's actually quite interestingly, she's only eating the base of the branches. So right where the branch is connected to the main stem. Now, I wonder if there's a little bit more nutrients there, or a little bit more sort of juice in that particular spot, and that's what's prompting her to feed there. And lovely late afternoon light creeping through from the west. Almost looks like she's unsure what to do. Oh no, she's going to take some takeaway with her. Yes, hello. Beautiful female. Listen to that crunch. Isn't that amazing? Now she just got that last little bit of that branch and she's rolling it around, trying to get the bark off. Now with a small branch like that, she might actually eat the whole thing. I'm not quite sure if I understand Kelly C. in Florida's question. So that apart from, oh no, I do, I get it now. Sorry, Kelly, I was being a bit doff. Doff is a South African colloquialism for stupid. Kelly's saying, what is the best way to identify elephants outside of their tusks and sort of genetic aberrations? Ears are probably a good one, shape of the ears, rips in the ears, but generally tusks are the best, and if they do have any abnormalities. And it is quite difficult often to identify different elephants, but generally the tusks are the best way. And see on her, oh, you've just got a glimpse as she turned. So on her right ear, she's got some holes in her ear. That's also another very good way of identifying elephants. But there we go, off she goes. And we're gonna start making our way down towards the quarantine clearings for fireside chat. So we will leave these ellies to meander on. Do you want a safety clap, Dave?
Yes, please.
So from one herd of elephants to some more elephants with Jamie.
In this case, more elephants that are having quite the tussle. Two young boys that are pushing each other backwards and forwards. I know that the visual isn't fantastic. They're on the northern side of our boundary, so on Booker's Hook. Oh, look how big and strong I am. I can push over a very small acacia tree. That's pretty intimidating. I'm pretty intimidated. Oh, do we have peace now? Has the victor been decided by his impressive display of pachyderm strength? No, we're going to go for the next tree now. Oh, no, bouncing back. We hear the tusks clashing. Clouds flying. This is the fantastic thing about winter. It's cool enough that we get elephants behaving like this, playing with each other. Oh, that was a serious headbutt. Practicing the skills that they will one day need to compete for the right to pass on their genes. And who better to play with and practice with than a cousin or a brother? Probably a cousin, they're about the same size, the same age. Oh, I think that might... Oh, no. Maybe he's going to back into him. Yep, he's coming back in. Little head shake. Generally, elephants are quite good at respecting the terms of combat. If your opponent turns his back on you, then it's not really considered good form to poke him in the backside with your tusks. They do occasionally forget that rule and do it anyway. All right, all that fighting worked up a serious appetite, and they've been distracted by the prospect of food. There's just elephants absolutely everywhere at the moment. Most of them are in some really dense vegetation, so I think we're going to leave our elephants for now. Start heading back towards those jackal that we saw earlier. I'm desperate to see how that scenario played out, but before we move off the topic of elephants entirely, Peter, you were wondering about whether it's true that elephants go crazy for oranges. It is absolutely 100% true. Any fruit with a relatively high sugar content, they absolutely love. They have been known to burglarize vehicles, break and enter into people's parked cars outside lodges in order to get to their supply of oranges, mangoes, whatever it is they can get their hands or at least their trunks on. So elephants love oranges, and I've heard stories about farmers up near Botswana that are citrus farmers, and as a peace offering to the elephants, they basically put all of the rejected oranges in a big pile, and the elephants converge there in the evenings to go and munch on the fruits. That's probably a vitamin C thing, but it's also a sugar thing. Very, very nutritious fruits. Speaking of which, I actually haven't managed to eat mine this afternoon. There's just been too many things happening. It's one of the big reasons why they really enjoy marula fruits. Marula fruits are exceptionally high in vitamin C. That's obviously a naturally occurring fruit that we get in this area. Very, very high in sugar and high in vitamin C. And there's a rumor, or at least an observation, that must bull elephants, in other words, elephants that are at that stage in life where their testosterone levels are up through the roof, and my word, they're just pachyderms everywhere. So many elephants. There you go, there's more of them. We're not going to linger, I don't think, but we've got more elephants here. An elephant in must will apparently target marula fruits specifically, just for the additional boost of vitamins that they need from it. That's a rumor though, it's not really 100% backed up by science. Elephants really do enjoy a good fruit. Now, I've never had anything stolen from my vehicle, Vim. I don't know if in any of your experiences you've ever had an elephant steal from you. I haven't. It's quite unusual, but you never know.
Monkeys robbed my car a couple of times.
Yes. Vim, spot on. We've all had our vehicles robbed by monkeys and by baboons. I had a baboon jump through my car window, take a sandwich out of my hand, and then jump out to the other side. I know that feeling very well, and it leaves you feeling a little bit confused, somewhat amused, and a bit like your personal space has been thoroughly invaded. I would be a bit more concerned if it were an elephant trying to steal it, or steal something from me. That's one of the reasons why in certain areas they will tell you not to leave fruit in your vehicle. If there are free roaming elephants that will go into the car park or wherever it is that you've left your vehicle. Kind of like when you're traveling and you're camping and you've got to be careful of bears and make sure that everything is stored away in those metal cabinets at campsites or whatever else they happen to provide. Elephants can be quite similar just with fruit. And hyenas with other stuff. There's lots of animals are opportunists. They will take what they can get. I'd offer the elephant my orange, but of course that's not something that we want to teach them. We certainly don't want to teach them that cars, that safari vehicles mean fruit. Otherwise we would have a major problem on our hands. That, and of course, we just don't feed the animals. While we make our way to the jackals, let's head back onto the back of Wendy.
Well, temperatures dropped incredibly quickly as the sun dipped below that western horizon. So just a quick update on those who might have missed the first part of the drive and what's going to be happening for the rest of the drive. Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard on Juma, we spent the first hour with her. We could hear cubs. They actually since have arrived. So the cubs were there. They are now feeding. We are not going to go back there. The sun is set below the horizon. That area will now be zoned. When I say zoned, it means no one will be able to go there. And that's because, firstly, there are two cubs there, and there's a kill on the ground. So it might attract lions and hyenas to have spotlights and cars crashing around there at night. So in certain parts of the Sabi Sands, hyenas are very clever. They've learnt to look for leopards where there's a spotlight or for leopard kills. So as a general rule, you never shine a spotlight on a leopard kill that's on the ground at night. So that's just to try and make sure we have as little effect on the wildlife as possible. But don't worry, I will be going there first thing tomorrow morning to try and find Queen Karula and the little ones. But great that they are back on Juma, really exciting news. And they are very deep in Juma. It's not like they're just inside. They are a good couple of kilometers away from the southern boundary where they have been kept. So maybe we might be seeing a bit more of them in the coming weeks, which is really exciting. Also, it's a fireside chat tonight. And for those of you who don't know what the fireside chat is, well, Jamie and I will get together around a fire, which is quite welcome during the winter months, and chat about the sightings and what's been happening during the week, as well as take a few questions. The questions for the fireside chat will be focused on the pangolin that Dave and I saw. First pangolin ever on Safari Live. And also, it is the Kruger National Park's birthday today. So we'll be doing a little celebration of birth. So let's try and keep the questions about pangolin and the Kruger Park. And we will be doing a different format of Fireside Chat this evening. It will be on our Facebook page. So it will not be on the normal platforms. It will be live from the Safari Live Facebook page. There should be a little notification you can turn on there to let you know when we're doing live broadcasts from Facebook. Otherwise, I'm not the best technical guy to ask this stuff. I'm sure most of you are far better than I am. So pop onto the Safari Live Facebook page. I'm quite sure you'll be able to figure out how to view this evening's Fireside Chat. But our the leopards have been a bit scarce. And then today, two different leopards, one down on Cheetah Plains, one here on Juma, and hopefully some more tomorrow. Also, the Nkuhuma lioness briefly this morning, and she's moving around hunting, but I'm quite sure she will be returning to the den where she's keeping those cubs. And fingers crossed, in the next week or so, she might move that den on to Juma, which would be really exciting. Imagine we have lion and leopard cubs on property. It will be a first since I have been at Safari Live, and I've been here now a year and 3 or 4 months. So, first time we'll have both lion, or it's the first time we've got both lion and leopard cubs to some of our wonderful characters. And as I say, who needs a soap opera when you get to see what's happening in the bush every day? Dave thought that was funny. Dave had a little chuckle there. So I'm going to be going to set up Fireside Chat in a little bit, and you will be with Jamie till she joins me around the fire. And it is going to be quite spectacular with the sun that's setting behind us. And we always got to keep an eye out. You never know when the Nkuhuma lioness might decide to join us for a chat around the fire. I remember last week there was some banter on Twitter that maybe the Nkuhuma females might want to take over final control for a while. I think that would be a very interesting prospect, with, if we could speak lion, all of them telling us to chase the buffalo to final control. But I don't think that's going to happen. We're going to have to deal with our fierce ladies. And there are fierce ladies, lionesses in their own right, that sit in final control at the moment. Woo, chilly. Quite looking forward to getting next to that fire. And we are moving into the winter months, so it is going to be really great cat sightings. Less grass, the prey species under more pressure because there is less grass and less water. But while we go set up fireside chat, Jamie's got the jackals.
Just can't resist spending time with an animal that we've hardly ever got to see until recently. Oh, there was a big yawn there. Exposing those dog-like teeth. There is our black-backed jackal in the evening light. You can see that real clear contrast, really clear contrast, between the black of the saddle on top of his back and then the tan of the rest of his body. It's not terrified of a vehicle, but it's not 100% comfortable with it, which means that we can't get terribly close, but we can sneak forward a little bit just so that we can get... Oh wait, hold on. There might not be any point to going forward. Where are you off to? Such fascinating creatures. There's even records of almost packs of black-backed jackal in Eastern Africa, sort of big groups, and it won't be a pack in the traditional sense as we understand it with wild dogs, for example, but a group of adults and their offspring, their fully grown offspring. There's even evidence of them hunting adult gazelle, so an antelope just a little bit smaller than an impala. Well, that would be something. Hunting and killing, I mean successfully hunting adult gazelle. That would be quite the sighting to experience. We don't tend to think of jackals as hunters. We think of them as very cunning scavengers. Apparently they are more than capable. I have seen them hunt baby impala before, but unsuccessfully. Still ranging about, basically just looking for any food that he can find. Could well be a young black-backed jackal, judging by the condition of its teeth. That's what I first thought. Very, very clear white teeth. In other words, it has now dispersed from its parents and moved on to look for, first of all, for a mate and then for a territory of its own. They are territorial. But the males and females, we discussed this morning, but males and females of both species will mate for life, or at least be entirely monogamous, and maintain their little territories. And just bear with me one second, I just want to make sure that the side-striped jackal are not hiding somewhere here. This is where we left them. There's only the black-backed jackal that I could see. But that side-striped pair also hanging about. Makes me wonder, I mean, there's a good chance this is part of their territory, and yet we hardly ever see them here until recently, or we hardly ever see them here until recently. Let's try and get another view of our black-backed jackal. Let's go forward a little bit in case the side-striped are somewhere here. I've already checked that side of the road, and we'll travel along the fire break for a bit. It's something that I haven't heard terribly much while I've been here. and I have missed the sound of jackals calling. They sound a little bit like they are singing. It's the most incredible sound, particularly side-striped are less vocal, but black-back jackal can be particularly vocal. Not something that I've heard once since I started working here. I used to hear quite frequently. My very first job in the bush was in the Kalahari, in the southern Kalahari, and we used to hear them singing to each other all the time. Beautiful, kind of like the equivalent of a wolf howl piercing through the night. And I'm hoping that our increased number of sightings of jackal might just mean that we might get to hear them more frequently. It's also one of the reasons why I've come back to this jackal, in this sort of faintest, slightest hope that it might decide to call. It would be a wonderful experience. Ashley, you were wondering whether or not the increased presence of the jackal might have something to do with the drought. The fact that the predators are more successful than the predators and the scavengers. I think it's a little bit, maybe, I mean, it's entirely possible. I think that it's a little bit too soon for us to be experiencing such a sudden change in population numbers. I think that will be more of a gradual thing. However, apparently, and I haven't been able to find any conclusive evidence of this or why this might be, but apparently jackal populations do this. They spike and hit the carrying capacity and immediately drop. And go very, very low. I'm just looking at this drag mark here. I'm 100% certain that this is from the buffalo that we saw the hyenas playing with earlier. There you go. See here, the drag, the soil has been disturbed, sticks been moved. It's quite easy actually to tell the direction of this drag mark. It's actually relatively easy to follow a track like this in terms of looking for wherever they've taken it. Let me just hear that again. I'm just going to be quiet for one moment. Taking my earpiece out. Sounded like they were kudu barking. Did you hear that, Liam?
On the sound of like baboon alarm calls.
I think baboons. Could well be baboons. We've been seeing that troop more and more. I heard it. It came from my right side, which means that my earpiece blocked it out ever so slightly. But let's go and investigate, nevertheless. Our jackal has appeared to have moved off. So we shall go and investigate and see what's causing the sudden alarm. Whether it be kudu or whether it is a baboon. Oh, back to Ashley's question. Yes, so we might be just in the sort of the upswing of the jackal population recovering. There's theories put forward that they do this because a jackal is actually a very resilient animal and they breed quite rapidly. So about once a year, a female will have pups, but she has quite a high success rate. So an average between 2 to 4, but up to 6 pups at a time. And with a relatively high survival rate, a jackal population can increase quite quickly. And the theories go that essentially what happens is they hit their carrying capacity and a disease will sweep through the population really quickly. But it's difficult to imagine what sort of disease it would be that would act so negatively on the jackal and not on other animals. Although of course now we've got this terrible situation with the wild dog pack in Lower Sabi, all contracted canine distemper, and that wiped out an entire wild dog pack in the space of a couple of days, which is utterly devastating for an animal that is so critically endangered as it is. Like it was coming from, oh, roadblock, Sorry, boy. You came as a surprise to me too. Big, very big buffalo ball. Sorry about that, boy. Didn't mean to startle you. So busy looking for alarm calling animals. The reason I'm racing in this direction is because it could well be that lioness that's moving through the area. It's cool enough now that she'll be on the move, quite possibly looking for the rest of her pride mates. It sounded like it was on this side of the road. Again, directions are a bit tricky. I have an earpiece in, but I think it was from somewhere here. We go off in search of a lion, implementing any tracking skills, which is always a bit more tricky in the dark. Kathy from Tennessee, welcome to the Sunset Safari. He wants to know how much of a role does our nose play in tracking? Because obviously, from your side of things, you can't smell what's going on. That's of course the next step, for maybe a couple of steps removed from Wild Earth, would be to include the experience of smell as well. Like those cinemas that very briefly made a sort of an immersive experience. I'm not sure how successful they were. Kathy, first of all, be relatively thankful that you are spared this sense that we occasionally have to experience, like the odd buffalo carcass. That's always an interesting experience. Our noses do play a role. Tracking elephants, wild dog, and just realizing that there's water buck in the area can play a very important role. Sniffing for carcasses can also help. I have found a carcass once by smell, but that was not a nice story. We won't go down that road. But I can't say I've ever found a lion kill before by following the smell of it, but the smell has helped, definitely. It gives you a general direction. If you can check where the wind is coming from, you get a rough idea as to where that carcass might be. Now those are the only real way that your nose will play a role in helping you to track an animal. And that's the limit of my experience. Wild dogs is probably the best example of where smelling them can actually help. The thing about that though is that their smell lingers for quite a considerable period of time after they've passed through an area. Now you'll drive, we've had a few sightings where we've madly rushed around following wild dogs and then they've crossed over our boundary and out of our traverse area, and you go back along the same roads and you're constantly looking around because you're aware of that wild dog, wet dog smell. There are, of course, I've been dismissive of the idea, but there are, of course, times where I really wish that we could share the smell that we experience with you. The petrichor is the clearest example, the smell of the earth after the rain. But some of the flowers are particularly nice smelling, especially in summer, after a good rainstorm. But there are times where a sense of smell would come in particularly handy, and be able to share the sense of smell with you. I haven't seen anything that would be alarm calling at a lion. Doesn't mean it didn't come from around here. I'm just trying to make sure. Oh, somebody's on their way home. Oopsie daisy. Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
How are you?
Good. Good, and you?
Good.
How's it, Herbert? Do you hear anything alarm calling this side?
No.
No. I thought I had a kudu, but maybe okay. Zoe's, maybe okay. a bit further.
Do you have Stefan's number?
I do. Herbert, I can't.
Okay. Okay.
Have you? Has he got yours? He's got your phone number.
I'm not sure, but I'll call Rebecca anyway.
Okay, sharp. She says okay. she'll send it to you.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, cheers, Herbert. No shame. Trying to get a hold of Steph. That was Herbert, by the way. He's recently joined our team, and Stefan is our ops manager, our operations manager. So he is in charge of keeping us all together, making sure everything stays organized and working, and a job that he is eminently capable of. He's also one of the most gifted and experienced guides that I have ever had the pleasure to learn from. And Herbert has recently joined the team as a combination of tracker and teacher for us in terms of some of the knowledge that we might be missing out on, particularly local knowledge of the medicinal uses of plants and trees and animal behavior, and then also to act as additional security detail on the bushwalks, so to sort of scan ahead and make sure that we don't run the risk of endangering ourselves or indeed an animal whilst we're out in the bush on foot. And the poor thing is clearly looking for Steph's number, but we will arrange to get that to him, never fear. Rebecca in final control has got it under control. Can't even remember what we were talking about. Got distracted. Oh, I do remember what I was about to say. I'm going to say that I'm trying not to get too far away from the quarantine site of our fireside chat this evening. And don't forget that we will actually be finishing our normal broadcast 15 minutes earlier than we would normally. The fireside chat is only going to be 15 minutes long, and it is only going to be available on Facebook. And you'll have to go to the Safari Live Facebook page in order to view it. Now, for those of you who are concerned, since you don't have Facebook, please don't worry about it. You don't need to sign up to have a Facebook membership in order to watch it. All you need to do is to go onto the Facebook homepage and search Safari Live. Put Safari Live in the search bar, and you will be able to view it there. So never fear. It will still be accessible to you, even if you are not on Facebook. And what that means is that it is a delicate operation in terms of my timing. Making sure we explore all of the nocturnal value of the bush before racing across to fireside chat. We have wonderful conversation plans. I'm not going to give too much away. I'm not going to give all of it away. But it may or may not involve a special sighting that Brent has had this week that I am in no way, absolutely no way at all, it would be ridiculous to suggest it, jealous of. A little bit jealous. That's okay. Our time will come, Viam. We'll find something. Let's see if we can't find a bush baby or a civet or a white-tailed mongoose before the end of our sunset safari. One thing we did notice while we were driving along Biffle's Hook cut line is just how many civet tracks there are on that cut line, up and down and up and down, which tells us that that is a regular civet highway. Civets do walk set pathways at night, and they usually walk the same path back. You almost always have one set of tracks going in one direction and one set of tracks coming back in the opposite direction. But it's building up that little bit of knowledge that for times when perhaps, just perhaps, we might be driving around in the middle of the night, we'll be able to plot out a little better exactly where we should go in terms of finding the right animals, the mysterious nocturnal ones that are always exciting to see. We've done so well now, I'm hoping that we might add another unusual animal list to our list before the day is out. And please let it not be a dacre hiding behind a bush this time. Don't think I could stand that embarrassment twice in a row. Just so that you can all rest assured, the sighting of Karuda is now closed since she hasn't put the kill up into a tree. She will be left alone for the duration of the evening and we'll just have to try again to see her in the morning. Now, as most of our diurnal animals start to head to bed, Kathy in Tennessee, you were wondering what happens to the oxpeckers at night. Obviously, they can't sit on the animals while they're wandering about during the dark, in the dark, or sleeping in the dark. And the answer, Kathy, is they go up into the trees. They do have regular trees that groups of oxpeckers will rest in. If there is if it is their breeding time, which isn't at the moment, but towards the start of the rainy season, they will return to the tree where the female has a nest site, usually in a hole or a hollow or something similar, quite often a dead tree, and they will return back there every single night. And oxpeckers are what are called cooperative breeders, kind of like the jackal actually, but in birds, cooperative breeders, basically it's exactly the same in a way. The previous offspring of the male and female will actually stick around and help with the rearing of the next set. And for mammal species, this confers a tremendous advantage. So let's go back to our jackal for the moment. Not all jackal offspring will stay with their parents and help. However, there is a tremendous increased success rate, very clearly demonstrable through statistics, in terms of the females that have helpers and the females that do not. And the females that do have helpers have a far higher survival rate for their pups. And it's not entirely clear what it is that prompts some pups to stay with their parents and help out and others to leave. It's something that nobody really knows or understands. It seems that the more dominant pups, the more adventurous pups, tend to disperse and go off on their own, whilst the more submissive ones are the ones that stay behind and help their parents. And it might give them an opportunity to have a little bit of increased protection before facing the big, wide, scary world. In other words, they are quite comfortable to stick with their parents. But it might also be that it's because they essentially will share an enormous amount of DNA with their siblings. I mean, they're essentially made of the same makeup, however different the genotypes might be. So they are, in essence, doing that, helping to forward that biological urge, which is to propagate one's own genetics. By helping siblings survive, they are doing that. And they're also, at the same time, gaining really valuable knowledge as to how they can raise their babies, what it is they can do to learn the skills. And I do think that there is a degree of skill involved. I'm just trying to work out, just ever so quickly, what planet that is. Apparently, Mars is meant to be exceptionally bright at the moment. It is very clearly a planet, and it certainly has a reddish tinge to it that suggests to me that it might be Mars. I'm going to have to double check that on my sky map and work out which one it is. Lost track now of the planetary movements. You can see how it's not twinkling, but a solid ball of light. Because it's reflecting the light of the sun, not producing its own, as a star would do. Awesome. I think it's Mars. I'm going to have to double check. I know Mars was meant to be quite bright at the moment. Now, if any of you